from Detroit, Michigan, USA. In My House, hosted by T. Carlita. Where the true stories are told and great music is played.
And the money and the power to the people.
Heard from our in-studio guest, Mike, Agent X Clark, standing by. We're going to talk to him live in just a moment. For now, I would like to let you know that in my house today, I have Mike Agent X Clark and Underground Resistance. Today's show, also on today's show playlist, will include music from our in-studio guests, of course, and we'll also have the Detroit techno music founders Juan Atkins, Derek May, Kevin Saunderson, and also the late Derek Jamerson Sr., and we'll be talking about him a little bit. And Derek Jamerson is the inspiration, and that is who this show is always dedicated to. And for now, we're going to get off into a little bit of our guests, Mr. Mike Agent X Clark, so you can get a feel for who he is before he begins talking live. Right now, what you're hearing right now is Techno City by Cybotron, aka Juan Atkins. This was done back during the 80s, during the Cybotron era. So take a look at that, and we're gonna get off into Mike Agent X Clark coming up. You are in my house, hosted by me, T. Carlita. In the studio with Mike Agent X Clark. Hi, Mike.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going good, going good. Glad to have you. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to be here. So, wanted to just kind of like talk a little bit with you about your history, shortly, briefly,
good
a little bit.
That.
So, I got a couple of questions for you.
Okay.
All right. Now, first of all, you know that this show was inspired by Derek Jamerson, Sr. We have to say Sr. now because he has a kid. And I know that you and Derek were friends. So how did you actually meet Derek? And when you met him, you know, how did you guys start working together? Just tell me a little segment of that. How'd you guys meet?
Well, actually, another thing that I also do is martial arts. Mm-hmm. I was doing a martial art demonstration at a drug rehab center.
Mm-hmm.
Lighthouse.
And Harbor Light.
Harbor Light, yeah, Harbor Light, because it was 25-30 years ago.
Yes, quite a while. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a minute ago. But yeah, anyway, my martial art teacher, he introduced me to Derek right after we did the show. You know, we met some of the people who were there attending the demo, and he was like, "This is keyboardist I want you to meet." And at that time, I was working on some music, and I was really looking for a keyboardist. My partner Nico Marks, we was already doing some stuff when I was with Mike Banks, and you know, we did the Underground Resistance stuff. So basically, we had started the Happy Records label. We was mm-hmm. looking for that first track. Mm-hmm. So when I met him, you know, I was looking for a keyboardist. He was a keyboardist. I was like, "Cool. When you get a chance, you can come over to the house." I'm looking for a keyboardist. He comes over to the house. We laid the track down. I was so impressed with his playing. I brought him over to Mike. I was like, "Yo, check this dude out." And I worked at the hair salon. I went to the hair salon.
Can you please mention that hair salon that you used to work at?
Terry's Place.
Uh-huh. Can't believe martial arts, do hair, DJ. Man, what is it you don't do?
ADHD. You know, what we gonna do, right? They make songs about that.
There
now.
You go. Yeah, they do. That's true.
But yeah, after I got off work, they finished that track.
Wow.
Yep, and that was the beginning of the first track that we did for Happy Records.
Okay, that got to give it up, too.
Yep.
That's the one that I play all the time. It's been playing on this show,
yeah.
Actually.
I mean, it was so cool because it was like we started at my house, and I left him at Mike's house, and I came back. It was done. Like, okay, cool.
Yeah, Derek was good like that.
Yeah.
So you have – I've been – doing some research. I mean, I know you personally, so now I gotta get to know you professionally. Mm. So I had to kind of look around and see what, you know, Mike Agent. I need to know what Agent X was. I know who Mike Clark is. So I had to find out who Agent X is and beat down and all that. So there was one on there that I really liked. What is in the mind of a professional DJ? You're walking down the hall and it was like you were smoking your cigarette.
The documentary.
Yeah. So I'm going to ask you that question. What is in the mind of a professional DJ? There must be a difference because you made sure professional was shown.
Oh, well, I am old school. So before I start sounding old school, I'm going to just say this is how I came up. As I came up as a DJ, you know, this was like before the digital age, before the 1200s, when, you know, you were working like two live records and it was live DJ, live drummers, you know. So basically, we practice a lot on the techniques until we got the techniques down packed. That's the professional part of your, you know, technique of your work. Mm-hmm. The other part is, you know, when it came to doing business, you handle business accordingly, you know, just as far as, you know, whether you did a contractual situation or not. You know, bottom line, you didn't sell yourself out or your fellow DJs. Everyone had like a certain standard and price, and you treated it just like any other job that someone would have. And that's what I mean, you know, when it's what you do for a living, it's your job. It is you. You are a professional at it.
Okay, that's good. Now, you've worked with some of everybody, the who's who's and the who's who's and the who's who's.
I've been blessed.
Yes. And throughout your life cycle of music, you started your own company. Mm-hmm. Beatdown.
Correct.
Records.
Correct.
How'd you do that?
Well, it was a timing situation because the actual reason I created Beatdown, when we were doing, you know, the whole techno thing, you know, as I've always said in all the documentaries, the word techno and the word house originally didn't have too much of a difference of meaning. It just was, in the city of Detroit, we called it techno. In the city of Chicago, they called it house. So when we were doing all our music, whether it was instrumental or vocals or whatever, it was considered techno, you know. And basically, when you have, you know, those type of idioms, that's just kind of some of the things that you use, you know. Mm-hmm. So, let me see, how can I put it? I guess without getting too far off.
Well, I know one thing that might help bring this a little closer and shorter. As I was finding and doing research on Agent X, I noticed, like, a lot of your music, even though it's house music, it has a hard beat. It has a hard bottom. It has a hard pound to it. It has some
snappy edge.
Yeah. So what is it? Does that have anything to do with it?
Well, a little bit. It's just keeping it where it belongs. But, you know, just kind of making it as short as I can. The Detroit sound, is the Detroit, you know, original sound that no one really got a chance to hear. When I say that, techno was given a certain name and a certain sound and a certain thought behind it. And if the extreme version of it did not fit a Detroiter at all, because, you know, most people think of techno as instrumental, a lot of different type of triggered sounds, not necessarily acoustic sounds. Mm-hmm. So when you think Detroit, you think techno, you go straight there. But, you know, Detroit is home of Motown, soul, jazz, funk, the whole nine. Your typical DJ played that coming up. Everything we played was soul, funk, jazz, blah, 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 blah. So with that being said, during those times, it was hard for a DJ coming out of Detroit to be branded unless they play straight techno. Mm-hmm. Me being a DJ that did not come from the background of techno, coming from the background of, you know, the other, you know, musical styles, I had a friend of mine in Switzerland, and he heard me and all my friends saying, okay, when you DJ, when you play, did you beat them down? You know, it was just like a little coin phrase that we use. It was like, yeah, we did. So he kept asking what was beat down, because he kept, you know, answering these little questions. So basically, when he kept answering it, I mean, kept asking, I thought to myself, that would be like a cool term to brand what Detroit DJs do. You know, in other words, whether we playing house, funk, or whatever, I can say, well, we're doing beatdown, and the rest of the world will say, oh, that's what that is, you know. And in short, that was what started the company. And at that point, the people around the world was interested. I had a couple people that licensed Detroit compilations, which opened up doors for other DJs and producers to get licensed from overseas, you know, Japan or England or whatever. So in short, that was how the company got started. And now I fizzed over into a record label, which is Strictly Beatdown. Mm-hmm. Strictly Beatdown Recordings.
Okay.
Yeah.
So like I said before, you have this is going to be the last question for you. You've worked with a lot of people over the years. Mm. Is there any particular person that's out there now that you are really looking forward to, would like to work with?
Well, you know, there's a lot of different people that I've been blessed to work with. I have to admit, Josh Milan.
Where is he from?
He's from New York. Josh Milan. I've always loved his music. He was part of the original group Blaze.
Okay.
Love his albums, you know, love the whole thing where he comes from. You know, he's one guy. Mm-hmm. Over in England, and these are friends of mine. Katie Tatum, Phil Asher, Bugs and Attic, Afronaut, those guys, they make a broken beat sound, very funky, very jazzy. I love to put stuff with them on the label. Joey Negro, he's the guy who does a wonderful disco edits and stuff like that. Okay. I would love to work with those cats, you know, on some production. And, you know, that's kind of like that. I can keep going on and on,
right.
But at the end of the
right.
day.
There it is.
Yeah, you know.
Well, you know what? You know, we go way back, like P-Pat, Tic-Tacs,
yes,
basement
ma'am.
Parties at Yaya's, High Five. God bless her,
yes.
too. But I want to thank you for taking time, like I said, out of your schedule. First of all, coming on the show and supplying me with some music to play, and we're going to play some more of your music as long as this show rides out. So I really appreciate you again, my brother.
I want to thank you for actually having a show like this, because we don't really have enough Detroit shows, homebred, to talk about Detroit techno, quote-unquote, and things like that. So I'm actually honored to be one of the first ones on here, you know.
You're going to make me cry.
So I'm just, you know, blessed, you know. As you know, I went through a lot of stuff past month. I would like to send a blessing out. I lost my uncle about a month ago, Nate Lay. And as 2 days ago, my girlfriend who runs my record label, Sarah Townsend, she lost her brother to a tragic accident. And there's a whole bunch of other people out there, but I just want to, you know, do a personal dedication over the air to everyone out here who has lost someone. Bless all of you.
And I appreciate you for being here, Mike.
Like I said, I'm blessed to be here.
Thank you.
And I'm honored that you had me on here.
All right. So coming up, we have Underground Resistance waiting on us in the green room. They will be here. They're gearing up and getting ready.
Sound out there, hands down, because you're dealing with a city that's full of people that are working, people that are struggling. You know, when it comes to the music, it's serious. Everybody here takes music seriously.
Detroit as a city has got such a long musical history, jazz and blues and gospel music. That's amazing right there. But then, yeah, there's Motown. And when you look at something like Motown, a label that really changed the course of the music industry, I mean, the music world was never the same after Motown. I think that you've got some really strong roots to grow from. And this record is really where the word techno came from. The word techno became widespread because of this record right here. Richie Houghton, you know, this guy was from just across the river here. He had a huge impact on what was happening within Detroit and what happened within the scene.
Techno, this is where it came from. It came from Detroit. So it's an underground sound. It's beaten. It's working hard and definitely hitting harder than anything else you've ever heard.
In the 80s, you had crack. A lot of things to really, you know, put people down spiritually. You know, this was about a future that was exciting, and it was an escape from whatever negativity was going on. This gear, this is what transformed everything. This gave people the ability to get out of their situation and get to that other future, that other reality. Thing of what underground resistance is, I mean, underground resistance has gone on for centuries, you know, thousands of years. There's an underground resistance, you know, across the globe. And this particular label and the guys involved in starting it up, Jeff Mills and Mike Banks, had both experienced some stuff which really put them in a position of having to deal with their own brand of resistance.
I'm Mad Mike, I'm 38, and you are founder, co-founder, me and Jeff Mills. I learned very early that fame and fortune was fleeting, and they only lasted as long as you had enough sense to keep it. And for many people, that wasn't long. I noticed that a lot of the people we had put out had stepped in front of their music in their effort to become famous. But when I saw how many of the black artists had became famous and got material shit and then f***ed it up, lost it all, look like really shouldn't make a big of a difference. Our thing was really, I'm nothing in comparison to the music. How can my face be more important than sound and the gift that sound brings to people?
You know, the first track on your album was called Your Time Is Up, with this woman named Yolanda on it, doing vocals, and Mike and Jeff Mills together had produced the track, and it was house. It was house music. What happens is later on, a more hardcore sound started to come out of UR. Then you have the whole Nation to Nation, World to World albums, later Galaxy to Galaxy, which has grown into Universe to Universe, the whole high-tech jazz sound. People always come by and ask, where's the UR studios? Well, there is no UR studio. What happens is each producer has their own studio. Everybody's responsible for really digging in and coming up with a sound that really defines what it is they're doing. You got a guy like Andre Holland, you got Billy Bob. What happens is on top of that, you've got the bands. You've got Interstellar Fugitives. You've got folks who have releases out proper, folks like Mark Flash, Nomadico, DJ Scourge.
I never started listening to techno until probably the mid-90s. A lot of that music wasn't getting played on the radio, so you really had to go out to the clubs or the parties to really hear it. As I started asking around about the names, this UR label kept coming up.
UR is really something that people come to when they've got something they're trying to express. They recognize that UR is a really strong vehicle for that.
I got hooked up with Underground Resistance through Deshaun Jones. He's the saxophone player, and me and him are the newest additions to Underground Resistance.
I didn't know what I was getting myself into, to be honest, because Cornelius came to me and said, you know, well, we pick up different saxophonists as we go along, and I'm thinking it's just a local band that does dates, but I had no idea that it was at this magnitude.
365 days ago, I never liked techno. I wasn't into it. I didn't understand why people enjoyed it so much, but I saw how energetic people were when they heard the music that we were performing, and I got to meet people, and they just described how techno has changed their lives. It was life-changing for me.
Mark Flash, UR078, DJ producer for Underground Resistance.
I'm Nomadico, aka DJ Dex, UR061. I'm also a producer and tour DJ for Underground Resistance. I've been involved with Underground Resistance for actually 7 years now. My whole original intention of like working with these guys was because I kind of came from a similar background, you know, just like working class, but still interested in art and music and like basically expanding my horizons beyond like my neighborhood, which is what, when I came here, I found that these guys were really all about.
Most kids in my neighborhood never even get a chance to get out. They grow there. I've seen my friends that I grew up with, they're still there. Still, you know, some of their parents haven't even left the neighborhood. Don't even, like the mall. Like, let's say a mall's in a different city. They haven't even been to the mall in another city. They shop in the same neighborhood. Spend their money in the neighborhood, which is good, but, you know, broaden your horizons, you know, see the world.
Let me see. I could actually, let me throw this on real quick. If there were no problems, you know, what type of music would have came out of the city? You know what I mean? If everything was, you know, suburban, you know, if this wasn't the place where that riots happened, it just wasn't a place where all those different civil rights issues went down.
The history of UR is important in that, you know, you need to understand that the history revolves around people who are fighting against stuff and trying to make things better and trying to find their voice. And so that's what this is about for me. This is about new dreams and being able to have new dreams and being able to go there and being able to say, look, you can have these dreams, and you know what? We're going to try to make those dreams real.
I think the real truth behind this music is we actually live this music. You know, this isn't a trivial thing. This is my life. This is John's life. And I depend on this. I depend on this to get me to where I need to be. So the music has a whole nother meaning because it's my life. And that's what Mike Banks has done for John and for myself. Because truthfully, just to call it for what it is, we're the future of this music. You know, we're like ambassadors, I guess, to the rest of the world of what it means to make this music and really make it happen.
I know for me as a musician, when I create something or play in front of people, the people give the energy. I can play better than I can normally. So truly, you have to ask the question, is it you playing the music or are you getting played?
Studio with Underground Resistance. We're live. Welcome. Underground Resistance. Thank you for coming.
You're welcome.
So,
thank you for having us.
We appreciate it. But we got to get a little personal for a hot second, Mike, before we get into the UR story, because I have something I have to say to you. Mm. You know, I first met you on Grand River through Derek Jamerson, which this show is inspired by, when you all were on Grand River. And at the time, you were looking for a journalist for UR publication. And I wanted to thank you for giving me my first job as a journalist. Especially back then, I didn't know what the heck I was doing. But you were the motivator. You kept me going. You like, you got this, T. You can do this. So I wanted to thank you. And now who would have thought, you know, some odd many years later, I'm interviewing you now.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, you always had the spirit.
I thank you. And like I said, you know, this show is inspired and dedicated to Derek. And it's sad that, you know, he's no longer here. And I know that you had a very strong, unconditional relationship with him. Mm. And family is important to him. You know, our children, Jennifer and Derek, who are adults doing their own thing. Jennifer now got her own children, twins. And, you know, it's sad that, you know, Derek's not here to see it. And now that's why when this opportunity came to do the show, that's why I had to do this show. And my son, Lamar, you know, he comes, reads meter, and he talk about Uncle Mike is cool. Uncle Mike is cool. Love his stories. He keep it real. So just briefly, you know, this is documenting history and his children and now his granddaughters. They're going to see this show one day. Can Uncle Mike just tell them a little something about how Derek was when it came to his music and his love for his family?
Oh man, that's a tough question. I think Jamerson was, yes, you know, sometimes being a genius can be a curse. And I think he was just so gifted at music. Me and my man was in there talking about it earlier. He was so gifted at music that sometimes he would lack in other areas in life, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he loved all y'all. Man,
and we going.
This is deep. We would talk about, you know, he had a particular problem he was dealing with,
right?
And you know me, I couldn't give him nothing but the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth was, you know, why don't you leave something your kids would be proud of? And he studied. He was kind of new to house music and all this type of stuff, but he studied and worked, and I mean, faster than anybody in the UR crew ever did. He came out with some bad stuff. I mean, his stuff was crushing, and you know,
I would be coaching him, and I ain't expect to see him back for a month or 2 months or 3 months, and he'd be back the next day. You know, and he really just wanted to leave that music. I don't think he expected to check out as early as he did.
Right.
Nobody, I don't think any young person expects to check out, but in a strange way, he would always say, make sure my kids know I did focus and I did accomplish something. And he did. And I'm going to say this. Sometime in a musician's life, their creation is kind of like where we had a mask on. Right. You know, his music was from God, and anything from God is greater than the person that made it.
Right.
And so when God called him to go do whatever he do, now he called him and took him in. But the stuff he left on earth, to me, is still, people appreciate it around the world, but I'd be real happy when his own people can appreciate it.
And that's why.
But that's radio, that's music business industry.
So. Right. And that was the reason why when the window of opportunity opened for me to be able to do this show,
yeah,
that's why I jumped in it, and that's why I wanted you to be here,
yeah,
and to tell that story and to set this thing off so people will understand, you know, who Derek was. They saw him one way, but we know who he was.
The music is deeper. When a DJ, imagine you got a guy who's been passed on,
mm-hmm,
and his best moment might be in your left hand.
Right.
You know, like David Ruffin or any of them great. You know, when you mixing that music together, I think about it a lot.
Right.
When I listen to Tammy Terrell and Marvin Gaye,
right,
singing "Ain't No Mountain High Enough,"
mm-hmm,
and you could just hear the hope and the future and the fun they was, right, having. You could hear all the good spirit in their voice,
right?
Even though we know they met a tragic end for both of them,
right? Exactly.
You know, but look what they left us with.
That's right.
And that's how I look at Derek.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that. Now let's talk about You Are. Now, the story on the streets and the story in the history books and the story on the streets says, and I want you to confirm all of this, that it started with you and Jeff Mills. That's all I've heard. That's what I was told. And that's what I know. So you the man, tell me the truth so the world will know how You Are started. And if it was you and Jeff, how'd it happen? How'd y'all meet and do that, if that was the truth? Oh, and let me explain to my viewing audience, the room is dark, so don't adjust your laptops, iPads, and iThings. It's that way on a purpose because we're going to talk about that too. So you're not being deceived by your screen. So how do You Are start? You and Jeff?
I think any black man in this country can understand how You Are started. That's the answer to that question.
I knew you was going to say something like that. How did I know you was going to say that? Okay. I knew you were going to say that. How did I know that? Okay. So, here next to you, you have a...
Hello. How are you?
All right. You, how are you too?
I'm okay.
Now, you are one of the You Are artists, and you go by the name of...
Agent Chaos.
Agent Chaos. So, tell me about Agent Chaos. How'd you come on the doorsteps of You Are?
Oh, met Mike coming up.
You met him coming up.
Yeah.
Were you doing music before you met him?
I was making sounds.
You was making sounds.
Yeah.
Okay. So what's your vibe? What's your vibe like?
Just experimental sounds.
You like experimental sounds.
Yeah.
Okay. And You Are definitely offers that for you.
Yeah, definitely.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Agent Chaos. Mike, quick question for you. So... under You Are, everybody has a number. You're You Are 139, is that correct?
I got I have
several numbers. Okay. So give me the reason for it. What's the numbering? Where'd that come from, and what is that about, if you can share that? Because I want to.
It's kind of like in prison. You become less than, and you just a number, as in compared to the music.
Okay, so the number, basically you're taking the.
You got to earn a number. If you got a number on you are, that means your music made it through the gauntlet, and you actually had a release on you are. There's guys in you are that don't have a number. So it's kind of a rank system, as well as a humbling system, to make a person just realize that, you know, he's small compared to the music.
Okay. Wow. I didn't know that. So what are some of the current projects? You got some current things going on, and you got some new artists. What's you are doing now?
Well, you know, you've
been around a long time.
You are as a... It's always been kind of a boot camp. You know, Mike Clark went through it, and Rob Hood went through it.
The boot camp, okay.
Drexia went through it. Mm-hmm. And I ain't the easiest guy to get along with neither, because as they get better, you know, they think everything they made is the stuff. And I'd be like, well, no, you know, that one ain't this and that one. So, you know, like teenagers, cats, they step out on their own and do their thing. But, you know, it's always some new cats that want to try something and get on. And, you know, they get tired of whatever genre or what they in, playing top 40 or, you know, whatever it is they may be doing that they become. And they start searching for something else. And eventually, I'm real glad that we have a place in Detroit that some brothers can knock on the door. And possibly get into something really forward. I wanted to backtrack to him.
Go ahead.
Yeah, me and Jeff had a lot to do with the formation.
Thank you.
Of you are, but certainly the trials and tribulations and struggles of people in front of us had more to do with it.
Okay.
So if that's any help to that particular question,
that does.
Yeah, but We certainly were amazed by, you know, all the intelligent music that could have come out on the radio, and Jeff wasn't allowed to play it, or they told him to fade off of this or fade off of that.
Mm-hmm.
And that limitation, you know, the Mojo and guys like Hump and them, and them cats was playing free what they wanted to play, and people became progressive listening to it. And then for the radio to start choking it down, I'm really disappointed in some of the stuff I hear now. It sounds like nursery rhymes, you know. And you know, I think a lot of our people can stand a little bit more than a nursery rhyme. But you know, if that's the level that they think we at, you know, that's a bad mistake. So you know, we wanted to move forward, and we decided that it would be a boot camp for talent, and with the emphasis on eventually becoming independent and doing your own thing. You couldn't stay forever. And the guys I have now, Timeline, Mark Flash, my man 061 Dex, I got Milton Baldwin up there, they all are coming along with their productions, and you know, we taking chances, putting it out there. Sometimes they ready, sometimes they ain't, but I'm proud of what they're producing, and I'm more proud that we was able to give, you know, some help back to the hood, you know, because I felt like we had failed. I still feel like we failed, and our mission was to do like what Mojo did, and the men that played around him, and they age group, they played some progressive stuff and taught kids to be progressive. And we wanted to do the same thing for the hood all throughout the United States. We really didn't know nothing about the rest of the world. That just kind of happened. But, and I still feel to this day, we got a lot of work to do. Cause like I said, they're playing nursery rhymes on the radio. So, you know, we just had our work is cut out, and hopefully one of these kids that we bringing through now, I'll figure something out that rings a bell, and who knows, maybe that great time, that small window between 1970 and the mid-90s, that when all that great music was getting played on the radio, maybe that window can reopen, because it's definitely shut tight right now.
Well, I want to, again, thank you, Agent Chaos, for coming down, being part of this beginning, this vision. I don't really know where it's going, but I just knew that the window was there, it opened, and I had to take it out. Again, Mike, my brother, I love you dearly. Thank you for being here, and thanks for doing what you do through everybody. Like you said, it is boot camp. You bring them in, you school them, you do them, and if they don't do right, I know you kick them out. I know that much.
Yeah.
So I want to, like again, I said, thank you very much. Now, how can anybody that's interested in being part of UR, how can they get in contact with you?
Come on the North End and ring the doorbell.
There you go. There it is. You heard it here live.
Agent 3000 X. East Grand.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
All right.
Thank you.
So now we're going to get off into a little bit of what I like to call the birth of techno. A little piece that I put together here. As soon as I learn my switches.
Fresh water, salt, and techno.
This is the real facts of how this shit started.
Nobody was calling it techno music until I started calling it techno music.
I believe that a lot of people live off the blueprint of what we did.
It was just breaking overseas. There wasn't money, there wasn't fame, it was just music.
But that's what makes Detroit Detroit. It's a deprived sound trying to get out.
Derek and Juan and Kevin are truly the masterminds. If it wasn't for them, there would be no techno.
Who would ever have thought of making music with an old turntable and a scratchy record and sticking it in an abandoned warehouse or an abandoned factory site? I'll tell you who thought of it. People in Detroit, that's who did.
Techno music is underground dance music. You know, high-tech soul.
Techno music started in Detroit. Now I'm just going to give you a little bit of the little bit so you can see what it is. We're going to get into some Strings of Life by Derek May, a little Alleys of Your Mind by Cybertron Atkins, Bounce Your Body by Kevin Saunderson. Going to also finish this show out with another tribute song by Derek Jamerson Sr., Got to Give It Up. I want to give a big shout out and a thank you to my family, the In My House staff. Thank you for being here, Mike. Agent X Clark. Again, you are. Thank you so much. To all my Facebook fans, love you dearly. Twitter followers, thank you so much. And to all the producers and the DJs of this great music that we call techno and all around the world. And if you would like to submit music for this show or put something in the playlist or be a studio guest, you feel free to send me an email. inmyhouse65@gmail.com. That's inmyhouse65@gmail.com. And we hope you like us on Facebook as well. Now let's get off into this music.
You are In My House, hosted by T. Curry, where the true stories are told and great music is played.
Side by side.